Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are coming from on the planet. Welcome to this webinar, this presentation on the renamed Data Acquisition and Rapid Triage class. My name is Kevin Ripa, and I'll be taking you through what this class looks like, probably for the next, 45 minutes or so. We'll see how it goes. You can see where we say seizure to actionable intelligence in 90 minutes or less, and that's pretty much our tagline for this class. Now, what class am I talking about? Well, this isn't a new class. This is the Forensics 498, what used to be named Battlefield Forensics and Data Acquisition. We have recently undergone a name change, and so we're here to talk a bit about that. The new name change is Data Acquisition and Rapid Triage. That is the new name. Let's talk about who I am first, and then we're going to jump into what you would gain if you took this class. So first of all, I've been running a digital investigations company for a little over 25 years. I'm up in Calgary, Alberta, Canada. As far as I know, I'm the only digital forensics company in Canada that also has a Class 100 data recovery lab in-house. And we're also one of the very few digital forensics companies in North America that engages in, criminal defense work. We talk about that in the courseware, why it's important. And we dispel a lot of myths about what people think when they first think about criminal defense. I'm also a senior instructor for the SANS Institute. I teach Security 301, Security 401. I teach and co-wrote Forensics 498. I also teach Forensics 500 and Forensics 578. And if you want to know more about me, the URL for my curriculum vitae is on the screen. As I said, I'm the co-author of this class, Digital Acquisition and Rapid Triage, along with Eric Zimmerman. The class is broken down really into two different kind of sections, we'll call them halves. We spend quite a bit of time on data acquisition. And when we talk about data acquisition, I mean data acquisition from everything. We talk about data acquisition from a dead box removed hard drive. We talk about data acquisition when you can't remove the hard drive. We talk about it live acquisition, RAM acquisition, acquisition from Windows, from an Apple device, acquisition from portable devices, phones and iPads and different types of devices that you wouldn't immediately think about as maybe treasure troves of information. We talk about acquiring data off the network, off the wire, cloud acquisition, acquisition from websites, gathering information about that data acquisition, acquisition from the Internet of Things. Now, the other portion of the class is rapid triage, and this is where the tagline of the class comes from, going from seizure of the device or collection of the device to actionable intelligence in 90 minutes or less. And in many, many cases, it's much less than 90 minutes. We round the class out on day six, just with a little bit of value add. We've talked about, when the evidence isn't in the machine, where else could we potentially find evidence of activity or maybe evidence of website ownership? Maybe posters on a website, things like that. We go into that. But we also go into some data carving and raw data carving, and we'll talk about that in just a little bit. Here we have the kind of the layout of the courseware that we have within the SANS digital forensics ecosystem, and you can see that we're placed right here. And people often ask me, Kevin, what order should we take these in, or what would the next logical class be? The answer is, it depends. And here's what it depends on. There are essentially two very, what we would consider core classes with digital forensics, and they would be the 498 and the 500 class. Now, the 500 class is incredibly important from a digital forensic analysis perspective because it teaches the forensic artifacts within the Windows operating system in depth. We dive very, very deep into what information is on the hard drive, what information we want to leverage for our investigation. We often say that all of the information we use in forensics from the Windows operating system wasn't put there for our forensicating pleasure. It was put there to enhance the user experience. Microsoft didn't create something like the shell bags artifact. If you don't know what that is, that's okay. It's just an artifact. They didn't create that for us to do forensics with. They created that to enhance the user experience. So the user's experience on the computer is made to be quicker, made to be more responsive, these types of things. We've just figured out how forensically to leverage these to collect information about a user. So being that Forensics 500 is the core digital forensics class, definitely that is a recommended class. So many of these other classes here, and they're all fabulous classes, but no matter how they talk about their forensics, very much you need the understanding of the artifacts within Windows. A lot of these classes talk about or reference things like the RAM or reference things like shell bags or the registry or MRU lists or SRUM database, things like this. And so you may be at a loss in some of these classes for understanding, well, what is that artifact and where does it come from and why is it important to me? And that's where Forensics 500 sits. None of these classes teach you acquisition. That's not what they're designed for. They're all analysis classes of various types of data. Only Forensics 498 is in the space that teaches acquisition from everything. Forensics 518, Mac Forensics, doesn't teach Mac acquisition. Forensics 585 does not teach smartphone acquisition, for example. And so really, that's why we say these two are the core classes. It doesn't matter what order you take them in. If you want to be pedantic, obviously acquisition is important. Maybe the first level of importance before we start diving into what the information means. But many people have taken Forensics 498 after they've taken 500, and that's quite okay. It doesn't matter which direction you go. But these are the two core classes. Then when people say to me, yeah, but Kevin, where do we go from here? So I've taken 498, I've taken 500, what's next? Well, it depends. And you're going to hear that answer incessantly when we discuss forensics. What is it that you need for your work environment? Or what is it that your employers want you to do? Network forensics? Incident response? Incident response for ransomware. What about the cloud? Memory forensics. There are so many different courses here. So the answer is it depends. What are you doing? There is really no order to be taken after 498 or 500. What is it that you need? If you're going to be utilized in cloud forensics, well, maybe that's the next logical choice. If you're going to be doing Mac forensics, maybe that's the next logical choice. What if you're going to be doing smartphone analysis? Maybe that's the next logical choice. Hunting on the wire, incident response, maybe that's your next choice. I can't tell you. So, back to Forensics 498. When we talk about Forensics 498, and we talk about the digital acquisition and rapid triage, this is basically what you're going to be presented with. We have six different sections loosely divided up into 6 days. We have section one where we talk about scene preparation, scene management. We talk very deeply about storage interfaces and how things plug into each other. In section two, portable devices. your cell phones, your iPads, these types of things. We talk about that. And we start getting into acquisition processes, setting the stage for how do we prepare for our acquisitions. In section three, we start diving into rapid triage as well as the actual data acquisition from Livebox and Deadbox. We talk about mounting evidence. We talk about memory acquisition. In section four, we talk about non-traditional and cloud acquisition. How do we get data off of RAID arrays or network attached storage, massive multi-disk storage? How do we deal with that? In section five, this is where we dive into Apple acquisition. We also get into the Internet of Things. Apple acquisition, really, really in-depth, really painful for some. You'll see why as we talk about it a little later. And then in section six, we go beyond the forensic tools. We talk about things like online identification. We talk about finding things online that don't exist online anymore. Huh? How do you find stuff online that doesn't exist online? Well, I guess you'll just have to stick around and find out. We talk about file and stream recovery, and we go into data carving, what your tools are getting, what they're not getting, maybe more importantly. Now, the difficulty that we face more and more today is this idea of data overload. When I say data overload, I mean that our data sizes are getting so big and created in so many different ways. The average endpoint at 2 terabytes, the hours and hours it takes to image that, it's just huge amounts of data, huge amounts of time. How do we make sense of this? Maybe it might be a better idea to target what you need specifically right now before you send the drive off for acquisition or full drive processing, this type of thing. So when we think about it from that perspective, and especially in understanding where our forensic artifacts live, it is fairly easy to say that 98% of the useful data that we will use in a digital forensic investigation comprises only 1% to 2% of the actual data on the drive. So maybe we need to think about a different approach. Maybe we need to consider going into the drive, first extracting that 1% to 2% of the data that is used 98% of the time, and let's start working on that. In that way, we can do that extraction and that parsing and that analysis and get to the important information within 90 minutes or less. Some of the different areas that we cover, and this is going to be very much a 10,000 foot view of the class, but some of the things that we cover are things like the UEFI, the BIOS, the RAM, different types of infrastructure. Now, why is that important? Because people aren't doing this. I like to think that we're doing it more and more than we used to, but it's absolutely critical that we grab this information. You cannot go back and get it later. If you don't grab it at the time of collection, it is essentially useless as evidence after that. The BIOS and the UEFI in most systems, they speak to the date and time of the files that were created or when they were modified. If the date and time of the BIOS or the UEFI are off, away from normal time, then so is any data created or acted upon with that false time. So now when you say that somebody did something at 2 o'clock on such and such a date, did they really? Or according to the incorrect BIOS time, was that the time that it happened? You can see how that can really change the impact of how we look at data on the drive. So it's of critical importance to collect this. And in the class, we talk about how to collect it. We talk about many of the places that data lives, from phones to networks to cloud storage to the Internet of Things, things like removable devices and unorthodox styles of device. We talk about cloud storage and what we mean by cloud storage, because cloud storage isn't just Azure and Amazon and Google's cloud. It's a number of different things. It can be things like your network attached storage or your OneDrive, things like this. We know that there's a ton of different interfaces on the devices that hold the data. More and more today, we're seeing these solid state drives, the M.2 drives, and in the NVMe categories and the SATA categories. All of the different connections, USB and IDE and FireWire and SAS and SCSI. What about all of these connections? What about adapters? How do we address these? What kinds of kits do we need to be able to address these interfaces? There's nothing worse than going on site and not being able to perform your function simply because you didn't have the correct adapter. Then we actually get into the BIOS and the UEFI. We talk about how do you access these? A lot harder today than it used to be because of something called modern standby. By the way, if you hear me talking about something that you haven't heard of before, you'd like more details on, certainly you could Google it, but I can tell you that everything I talk about here today, we discuss in depth in the class. That's why the class is 6 days long. One of the early things we do in the class is we talk about, once an evidence file is collected, what can we do with it? Well, the old school method was to mount the evidence file as a drive letter. We would collect things typically in an E01 format. This is just an evidence file format that we collect data in. There's a number of them. This is just probably one of the most common ones. And we have tools that we can use to mount these E01 files so that they look like a drive letter. So, for example, let me just show you what that might look like. Now, let's say that I have an evidence file. I'm going to go point it at one right now. We have this evidence file. You can see it's an E01 file. Okay. I can select that using Arsenal Image Mounter. And if you're using Arsenal Image Mounter to mount a file, it doesn't cost anything. It's a free tool as far as mounting is concerned. Now we see that it has mounted that E01 file, and we can go through this E01 file to look at the different artifacts that are in it. And we can drill down through all of the various different windows, and we can see everything as if it was just an attached hard drive. But we get to do more if we know that we can do more. And by the way, there's nothing wrong with what I just showed you. That is the way that forensics has been being done for decades. But wouldn't it be great if we could look at the image in the way that it looks to the user as they were using it? In other words, if we could take this E01 file and somehow make it boot, wouldn't that be cool? Well, we can do this. You see that I had mounted an E01 file, and once I mounted it, I can now use Arsenal Image Mounter to boot that E01 file. Now, this procedure is not a free part of the tool. You need to pay for the tool to have this feature. There are ways to do this for free. VirtualBox, it's fairly easy to do, relatively easy to do. And there's some other free ways that, you know, have some different difficulties involved in them. This is the easiest. And by the way, the Arsenal suite of tools, everything that Arsenal Recon makes, just amazing, amazing tools. And for the money, probably some of the biggest bang for the buck that you're going to find in the industry anywhere. So I highly recommend these tools. They're quite inexpensive relative to things like Ncase or FTK or Axiom or the really big forensic tools, and it does so many things that help us with forensics. So in this one example, I'm showing you how Arsenal Image Mounter will boot an image. So you saw that I had mounted a disk image to a drive letter, and then I went through some clicks to launch the virtual machine. We walked through all of this in the class, but you can see here that it's getting ready to boot something. I mean, this is turning into a, obviously looks like a virtual machine. We see the Windows logo here. And what it's doing is it's doing a bunch of backend emulation with the evidence file in order to present it to the system as though it was a computer we've pressed the power button on. And we watch it boot up. It takes a bit more time than it would take for a normal computer to boot, but you're going to see here shortly the benefits to it and how this helps us. And it's easy to lose sight of the fact that this is a forensic exam that we're doing. This isn't, we haven't turned on the subject's computer. This is the evidence file. And by the way, while this is happening, all the activity you're watching happen is being committed to something called a differencing file. And this differencing file is where it keeps track of everything it needs to do. Certain files need to expand. They need a place to change. And of course, we don't want that happening in an evidence file. So all of this is happening in a separate file, if you will, or set of files, so that the activity does not change the evidence file. I want to be very clear. No matter what you're seeing on the screen here, it is not changing the evidence file, not one bit. Once we shut all of this down and make it go away, the evidence file is exactly the way it was before we started anything. So you can see here, the little pinwheel down here, that clearly something is happening. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to just tell it to use my monitors. If we don't do that, then the graphics we get are not really optimal. And now that looks very much like a desktop. There is a password in place, but this is another awesome feature of Arsenal Image Mounter, the paid product. You don't need to know the user's password, because there is a bypass built into Arsenal Image Mounter. I didn't type the password in. I guess you'll just have to trust me when I tell you there is a password, but Arsenal Image Mounter was able to bypass that password without any input from the analyst at all. And we can see, obviously, the user we're logging into is a user named Hearns. Now, if you're wondering, Kevin, why do we bother with this? How does this help me? Well, I think it's going to become quite obvious here in just a moment when we get to the desktop, but there's just simply no replacement for being able to see the user's desktop the way that they saw it, to be able to interact with the machine the way that the user interacted with the machine. There's so much more that we can establish when we can see what the user saw. People put very personal things on their desktop in terms of the pictures that are there. That can tell you a lot about a user. What is on the desktop? Let's make this just a little bit bigger. Now, one of the things that we see here that's, I think, really, really important is the fact that we've got this sticky note on the desktop. Now, some people would say, yeah, but Kevin, how often do people have sticky notes on their desktop? And you would be right. I don't see it very often at all. But when you do see it, I mean, what a big deal it is. It's telling you so much about the user. We know that the user is, well, I shouldn't say we know this. If you're a person of a certain age, then you're going to know that this user is obviously a fan of the rock group Rush. But if we're trying to establish information about the user of this computer, this sticky note gives us some insight into, you know, maybe something the user is doing. Usually sticky notes are things like to-do lists. And this can give us a lot of information about that user. We could look at network connections, see what's trying to connect outwards. If we're looking for malware or something like that, we could potentially see it trying to create that outbound connection with a command and control channel, for example. So really, really powerful to be able to see and interact with the system in the way that the user did so. We talk about live response more and more today when we get to computers. These computers are on, and all we do today is close the lid. Very seldom do people power the machines down anymore. And so in that case, we have to be equipped to be able to respond to that situation. A lot of changing situations when it comes to live computers. I mean, what are we going to do with this? We're certainly not going to turn it off, and we'll see why shortly. But we have a wide range of abilities available to us that we teach in the class. Everything from very rapid triage, let's grab the important stuff we need to start moving the forensic ball forward, and all the way through to using tools to do a full image of the drive itself. And yes, we can do that when the machine is on. We have to talk about things like the order of volatility, make no mistake, but we don't turn the machine off. We collect the RAM first, and then we check for encryption, and then we will do an imaging depending on what we've found up to that point. Of course, what do we do in cases of write blocking? We have a drive. Whatever it is. I mean, there could be simple drives like SATA drives, but what if we've got drives that aren't simple? What if we've got the solid state wafer styles of drives? What if we've got drives with interfaces that are non-standard? And so maybe we don't have the physical write blockers for them. Well, we introduce you to a tool called SafeBlock. And SafeBlock is a software write blocker that automatically write blocks whatever's connected to it through any interface, giving us that forensically sound acquisition, no matter what it is that we're connecting. We talk about boot disks and what to do when the machine is off and how we could collect an acquisition. Obviously, if it's a desktop, we want to open it up. If we can remove the hard drive and image it separately, that might be a good idea. But what if it's a computer, especially like any of the newer ones, where the hard drives are soldered onto the board? Or we don't have adapters for the latest NVMe drives, M.2 drives. Now what do we do? So we talk about boot disks. We actually have a lab where you build a Paladin boot disk and you boot a system with that disk and perform an acquisition of the drive. So a lot of great features even up to this point. We get into image mounting and we talk about why taking that forensic image and mounting it as a drive letter is important. Obviously, for its forensically sound properties, we talk about being able to interact with files. Well, beyond being able to interact with files, you saw us actually boot the evidence file as though we pressed the power button of the computer. That's powerful. We can mount it as a drive letter to run scans on it, antivirus scans, things like that. Maybe we need to pull certain files out for further analysis. We can do that as well. Then we get into talking about triage, rapid triage. Remember, we talked about how 1-2% of the hard drive contains about 98% of the stuff we need for our forensic analysis. And we like to call this finding knowledge within the noise. And it's just a question of knowing where to look. Because if we were to break down a digital forensic analysis, and this covers a wide range of things that we might be analyzing for, doesn't matter if it's a hacking case or theft of intellectual property or you know, various different kinds of cases, very often the same types of Windows artifact files are in play. It's a question of knowing what those files are, where they are, and going and getting them. Things like your browser cache, the prefetch, the registry hives, jump lists, link files, the file system files like the master file table, for example. How do we go in and grab all of that stuff really fast in a forensically sound manner? Well, we spend a lot of time in the class talking about doing this quick win triage. One of the ways that we do it is using a tool called CAPE, the Kroll Artifact Parser and Extractor. We like to joke that that's the real reason you come to the class. Anybody who's done forensics for even a brief period of time has heard of CAPE, and it's just an amazing, amazingly powerful tool. It comes in a command line version as well as a GUI version. And this tool does the collection as well as the processing. And it is incredibly, incredibly fast. It can go through file systems and unlock files that are in use. If the computer's on, it will still unhook a copy of the master file table and extract that for our forensic needs. It can parse volume shadow copies. If you don't know what those are, well, we talk about those at length in the class and how they are of critical forensic importance. CAPE allows us to extract the data in multiple different ways for whatever reason we need it. We can pull it out just file by file. We can pull it out to a virtual hard disk. We could put it into a zip file. We could even exclude tons of data on the drive using deduplication and exclusion based on hash values. With CAPE, it will look at so many different file types, whether it be a mounted E01 file. It can look at a live drive. It can look at a mounted dead drive, maybe just a directory. It can reach external or remote devices through tools like FResponse. And again, volume shadow copies. It will search through those and extract the data that we've told it to extract. Once it collects them, we can then pull actionable intelligence out of them. Now, just to give you an idea of what that looks like and how that works, we're going to use it in a demonstration here where I'm going to go find actionable intelligence. I've got a machine that potentially has malware on it, and we've been asked to look at the machine to see if there's any evidence of malware running. You know, the machine's acting kind of funny. Can we look at this and decide rather quickly whether or not we need to pull this machine out of service? So I've started up CAPE here, and you can see that most of it's grayed out, and it doesn't start to show us options until we start collecting options. So for example, I want to use some target options. In other words, I want to go and collect stuff. So I have to tell it where I want to look. So in this case, I'm just going to tell it to look through the whole C drive. I have to give it a place to put the extracted information. So I'm just going to tell it to put it on the desktop, and I'm going to create a new folder, and I'm just going to call that new folder TDest for target destination. And that's where I'm going to put the stuff that I collect. You can see here that there's this flush command, a very important command. It's going to first flush any contents in this TDest folder before it puts new data in there. And it does that so that there's no commingling of data. We can uncheck that because there's going to be reasons potentially that maybe we're doing two or three computers and we want all of the data from the two or three computers in that one folder. Most of the time we don't, but be careful using this flush command because again, it's going to clean everything out of that folder. People are, well, a lot of people, myself included, when we download stuff or we extract stuff, we tend to want to put it on our desktop because it's easy to find. If you make the desktop your target destination, and then you enable the flush command, it is going to wipe everything off your desktop. Don't do that. All right, so our idea here is we're trying to find out if this computer's been infected. Is there any rapid triage, quick indications we can take from whether or not we need to pull this thing out of service if it's been used for anything nefarious? So there's a few files that I want to grab for that. The master file table is a big one. I like having that one. I like files like anything that can show history. So things like app compact cache, things like evidence of execution, because if it's evil, it's got to run, right? So I'm going to grab evidence of execution. I want to process my volume shadow copies because maybe there's copies of evil in older volume shadow copies that maybe have cleaned themselves up now. But I don't want to see multiple copies of the same file, so I'm telling it to deduplicate. I could output this in a number of different formats, but I'm not going to here. I could also exclude by hash, as I talked about. Now, if you've been noticing along the bottom here, and if you haven't noticed yet, keep an eye on this because we're going to continue working here. This command line here has been building based on the selections I've been making. Now, I want you to just keep an eye on this because now that it's going to collect the things that I want it to collect, and by the way, let's have a look at what this evidence of execution is collecting. This is what one of the files looks like. It's going in and it's grabbing my AM cache, my app compact cache, my prefetch file, my recent file cache, my sys cache. It's going throughout the drive and it's grabbing all of these files. It's going to pull them out to a directory that I've indicated, and it's going to parse the data in them. But what am I going to do with that once I've collected it? Well, this is where we use the module options. The module source, where am I going to look for files that I'm going to parse? If I leave it blank, it's just going to point towards tdest. But I'm going to point it there manually. Then I have to tell it where I want it to put the information, the parsed data, the final data. So I like to just put it on the desktop again in a folder called mdest. Module destination. Again, we've got this flush command we have to pay attention to. And then we've got to pick the parsers, the things that are going to do the work. Well, I grabbed AM cache, so I'm interested in that. I grabbed app compact cache, so I want to parse that stuff. As you'll recall, I told it I wanted the MFT. I extracted the master file table. So I'm going to run the master file table explorer to parse that out. It's not a human readable thing, unless you really like looking at things in hexadecimal. And then I'm going to run the prefetch parser, because as you'll recall, I grabbed the prefetch. So now I've told it what I want it to do. And by the way, if you've been watching, you'll have seen that this was all growing. Folks, this is an awesome, awesome feature. I can take what I've selected here, save it to a text file, rename it to .bat, a batch file. I can put this along with the CAPE executable on a thumb drive. I can send that thumb drive around the world, anywhere, to anyone, as long as they can plug the thumb drive into a computer and double click on the batch file, it will run this command. It will collect anything off the computer I want collected, and it will preserve it. I can process it if I want. Once it's all done, the user hasn't had to touch anything. The user just watches things happen on the screen, as you're going to see shortly. And when it's done, they remove the thumb drive, send it back to me for my analysis. So you don't even need to send people to remote locations anymore with a tool like this. But let's see what the tool's going to do. So we select execute. Of course, it gives us a warning about the flush options. And then a terminal window is going to open up, and you're going to see things start to happen. It identifies the machine that it's running on. It starts to look for the files that I had told it to go look for. Now, it's a very, very smart program. It can tell the difference between the files it has to interact with. And by that, I mean, there is an advantage to working on these files in a certain order rather than just treating each file as its own isolated file. And so while it's doing that, it knows which ones it should do in what order. And so that's why you see these command lines that start with the word deferring. It's deferring the collection or processing of certain tools, certain files, until it's captured other ones. Now, this tool doesn't hang. Like some tools, if they hang, they stop working or something, you have no indication. You could be sitting there staring at them forever. CAPE is one of these tools where if it stops doing anything for about 60 seconds to 2 minutes, it's hung up. But you can look at the top here and you can see what's going on. Is it working on anything? Right now, it's running MFTECMD. It's parsing the master file table. Folks, a master file table is a big file. It's probably hundreds of megabytes with hundreds of thousands of entries in it. And this tool is trying to parse all this out and put it into a spreadsheet. So you can imagine this doesn't happen at the snap of a finger. So where it's sitting seemingly doing nothing, look at what it's doing. If we know a little bit about forensics, we're going to know that, hey, master file table processing is going to take a little bit of time. But we're going to see how much time it actually takes. Folks, I don't care what tool you're running. I don't care if you're running Forensic Toolkit. I don't care if you're running Encase, Axiom. Go pick any multi-thousand dollar tool at your disposal. And I can guarantee you that you are not going to process all of this information into a finished product in 130 seconds. In just over 2 minutes, we are done. You are not going to do this with any other tool at any price. You just can't. So let's go see what we discovered from here. I'm going to minimize this, and when we go to our target destination, this is where it went and collected the stuff that we wanted to collect. So we can see the C drive here, and in the C drive, we collected the master file table. We had also told it to go get some other stuff, app compact cache, and the prefetch file. But of course, if we were to, for example, look in the prefetch, there's not a lot we can do with this. I mean, this doesn't make sense, and double-clicking on it's not going to make any sense here. So it needs to be processed, and that's what the modules were doing. And so when we go into it this way, well, file system, there's the master file table parsed out into a CSV file. 237 megabytes. No wonder it took a little bit of time. Now, if we want to look at it quickly, well, Eric Zimmerman created a tool called Timeline Explorer. We can open up Timeline Explorer and we can bring in these CSV files. And Timeline Explorer is going to give us the ability to look at these, ingest them, slice them, dice them, look at them in a number of different ways to try to get answers quickly. So in this case, I'm going to go to my desktop and I'm going to go to MDesk and I'm going to grab that prefetch file I created. Now we're going to pull that into Timeline Explorer. Again, it's, what was it, over 230 some odd megabytes in size, hundreds of thousands of line items. There's a line item for every single file, folder, and object on the computer, including the master file table itself. Folks, this just necessarily takes time, but what kind of time? Well, you can see we went and grabbed all kinds of important files, and we processed them in just over 2 minutes. Here we've got 577,000 items. It's no wonder it took a bit of time to load, but it still was measured in seconds. But we're trying to find evil. If I want to know if evil's running, I am concerned about executables. That's what I'm looking for. So where do I see the execution of those? Prefetch is the first place I'm going to look. So I'm just going to play around with Timeline Explorer. I want to search just by prefetch alone. That's all I want to see. Again, in the class, we go through this in more detail. And in the Forensics 500 class, massive detail. You can see now we went from 577,000 lines of items. We now only have 536 lines. Folks, I can eyeball 536 lines. Let's look at this a little more closely. We've filtered on prefetch. Now I want to sort alphabetically by file name. So I double click on this. I'm going to double click again so that it sorts A to Z. And I'm just going to start looking down the list at things. And some of the things I see immediately, somebody's running bash. Why are my average users running bash? That doesn't seem right. CMD, the command line. Why is an average endpoint user running a command line utility? Why are they doing defrag? Defrag is commonly associated with trying to cover tracks or anti-forensics or deleting data. And really, it does a very poor job of any of that. But I mean, the end user doesn't know that. They've Googled around and it says, hey, run defrag. It'll destroy data. We keep going through here looking for things that are odd. I mean, one of the things I see as odd is just the letter F as a file name. We might want to look a little further at that. I think see things like HXD. Somebody installed and ran HXD. That's a hex editor. Why is my average user running a hex editor? There's a number of things in here that just look really, really odd. But probably one of the worst things that looks really odd is programs that are just completely out of place. Oh my posh. Is that out of place? I don't know. Maybe you don't know what this is, but the Google knows. So it's easy enough to go find out what the Google has to say about it. My user is running PowerShell. Why? My user ran RStudio. Why? My user ran sdelete. That's a file wiping program. This is bad. Now, when I say the user, I don't know if it was the user. It was somebody that used this machine under a certain user profile to cause all of this to happen. And then I see something like this, some kind of evil.exe. That's bad. That's very bad. So you see how it took me longer to talk about it than it did to actually do it. We can find out in very few short minutes some stuff that used to take us a whole lot longer to do. We talk about acquisition, as I said, via Deadbox, live acquisition. And we talk about preparing the destination media. Not just preparing the destination media, but how to select destination media. Hard drives are not all the same. Are you going to save your image out to a spinning hard drive? Are you going to save it to a solid state drive? What choices are you going to make? Because not all solid state hard drives are made the same. And not all spinning hard drives are made the same. But if you take an average spinning hard drive, which can take the data off of the subject computer and write it to an evidence file at a rate of maybe 120, 130 megabytes a second, if you're lucky, as opposed to writing that out to a Samsung T7 external solid state hard drive at a gig, that's massive speed difference. And time is money. We spend a section on getting at the media. How do we start looking for hard drives in machines? Now, for some of you, you might look at this and say, well, this is easy. I know how to do this. But there's a lot of people who just haven't picked up tools and taken computers apart before. Hard drives come in so many different shapes and sizes today that it would be great if we had a way to get at that, some instructions. And so we spend a bit of time on media removal as well as specialty media removal. What about if we've got hard drives in racks where we've got, in the case of the top picture, we've got 24 hard drives in there, in that array. How do we get them out? Do we want to take them out? If you look really, really, really closely, we see here it says SAS 900 gigabyte. There's 24 of these in here. That is almost 24 terabytes of data. If you had to image this array, how would you do it? Is it easy to go out and buy a 24 terabyte hard drive? And how long would that take? And how would you connect it to this to do it in the first place? How would you connect an SAS drive? Would you remove them one at a time, image them one at a time, and try to rebuild whatever array they're in? Okay, I realize that's an extreme example, but what about even network attached storage? This is just a two drive. And we don't even know if there's two drives in there. There may only be one. Just because there's two bays doesn't mean there's two hard drives in there. Is it a RAID 0, a RAID 1, a JBOD? We don't know. What file system is on this? Is it Windows? Is it Linux? It's very possible that it's both. The data living on the drives is emulating Windows, but it's a Linux system on the motherboard that's controlling the storage of the data. And if you don't know how to address that, you're going to be out of luck. Well, we talk about all of this. We talk about imaging things like a Surface Pro, where before the Surface Pro 7s, you couldn't take the hard drive out. And it only had a single port, one port. How do you interact with it? You can't. I mean, you could boot it and do it live, I suppose, but as much as we want to, or as much as we can, we want to image it in a write block fashion. So we walk through imaging a Surface Pro without turning it on. We talk about how we connect things, what we're going to connect, the fact that the keyboard is not going to work, the Surface keyboard is not going to work, the touchscreen is not going to work. And what changes do we have to make in the UEFI in order to be able to do the image in the first place? We cover all of this. We talk about Chrome acquisition. We talk about RAID. What are you going to do if you're faced with something like a RAID 6? How do I acquire that? What do I need to acquire? Am I going to pull each drive out and acquire them separately? Not on a RAID 6, you're not. We did a data recovery job in the lab one time. It was an 18-disk RAID 5. You're not going to image those one at a time and expect to be able to rebuild that data. Of course, virtualization is huge today. So many on-prem and, quite frankly, in-cloud environments utilize virtualization, vSphere, for example, to manage virtualization. I can go buy a whole bunch of physical servers. Or I can go buy one big robust server with lots of storage and processing and RAM, and I can host a number of virtualized servers on it. Well, how do you acquire virtual machines? How do I acquire RAM from a virtual machine? We talk about virtualization. We also get further into detail because it isn't just about doing the acquisition. It's also very much about what do I do with the acquisition? Can I use the acquisition? We go behind the scenes and we dispel a lot of the myths. Like people think that if I do an acquisition and then I do a verification and if the hashes don't match, I can't use it as evidence. Yes, you can. Will the court take my evidence? Why wouldn't they? Am I changing the data? Absolutely you are. What about write blocking? You can't write block live images. But how big of a deal is write blocking today anyway? I mean, we do phones all the time and you can't write block a phone. It isn't to say that we don't want to write block. We're going to write block whenever we can. We just need to understand that more and more today, we're not write blocking. There's legitimate reasons why we wouldn't. Why can't I just turn the machine off? If you turn the machine off and there's whole disk encryption like BitLock or something like that, and you don't have that key, you're done. You're not going to get that image. So besides just talking about how we get at this data, how we conduct forensic imaging, we also spend a bunch of time talking about dispelling the myths, talking about the questions and, you know, the things you may have heard around the table at work. Certainly, I spend time talking about a lot of the myths that we hear in the industry. We talk about remote acquisition. What happens if the data is not local to us? What if it's on a computer within our enterprise, but at a different location? What if it's in the cloud, like in OneDrive, or what if it's in Dropbox or Box or in Azure or in AWS or GCP? We talk about Office 365, now Microsoft 365, but we talk about grabbing information out of there, not just collecting PST files, but OneDrive. We talk about audit logging, which is a huge and useful, very important tool to be used in business email compromise investigations and incident response in the cloud, for example. And we talk about Google Takeout. How do we extract all of the information in a Google profile about somebody? In the fifth section, we go very deep into Apple. And Apple is a very, very different and in many cases difficult beast because it doesn't live like Windows and it doesn't act like Windows and it changes far more often than Windows. I have four different Apple MacBook Pros on my desk and every single one of them is different and is different in its approach. It's not like Windows where I just go in and I acquire the drive. It's not that simple. But we talk about acquiring RAM from Mac. We talk about Apple boot disks and live imaging and when you can do it and when you can't. We talk about some of the different file systems. We talk about whole disk encryption on the Mac called File Vault. And then we talk about the T2 security chip, which came to being in mid-2018. And how does that affect our acquisition process? How does that affect what we're able to do and how we're able to do it? The amount of interaction that you need to have with an Apple product before you can acquire it is terrifying to those of us who have only ever right-blocked a drive and then acquired it. You are interacting with this machine in an incredible amount of ways, but you have no choice. The alternative is getting nothing. I often make the joke in class that, you know, maybe the only takeaway you have after the Apple section is that I'm never doing Apple products. And if that's the takeaway, it's worth it, but at least you know what is involved. And we talk at great length about Apple collection. But we don't stop there. What about your network? What about extracting data on the wire? Everything in our network is connected and we need to collect this, whatever it is, if it's emails or pictures or documents or whatever it is. What if we want to collect all of the stuff out of a computer and save it to an evidence file? Well, if we know which computer it is, we can collect that off of the switch that it's connected to in the form of something like a span port. So we're going to mirror this data. But what if we want everything? I want all data in and out of the network. Well, we can do full packet capture using a network tap at our perimeter, for example. When we say full packet capture, this is every bit of data in and out of our environment. Both directions. Full packet capture. Someone downloads a file, we can pull a copy of that file out of the full packet capture. This can be indispensable in cases of incident response or data theft. When we capture the traffic, as I said, we capture it into these PCAP files. And then we use tools to pull these PCAP files apart so that we can see what kind of traffic is in there. In fact, we can rebuild the traffic. We do a couple of labs where we take full packet capture files, we pull them apart, we extract entire files and conversations out of them, all of this quick win stuff. And as if that's not enough, when it comes to the Internet of Things, oftentimes if we're talking about things like Nest thermostats or wall-mounted video cameras, security cameras, maybe internet-connected refrigerators or hairbrushes, pick your flavor, everything is connected today. How do we figure out what has data and what doesn't? How do we figure out if it doesn't actually collect and store data on the device, where is that data going to? Because the data is going somewhere. There's no reason to collect it if it's not going somewhere. So we talk about how we can look at all of this traffic and how we're able to filter and refine it and enrich it, isolate it and attribute it back to a specific Internet of Things device and figure out who it is that's accessing that device. Imagine you've got, let's just pick one example. You are executing your law enforcement, you're executing a warrant, and there's a camera on the wall in a drug house. Somebody's looking through that camera. Somebody's using that camera to see what's happening in the house. Probably be pretty important to law enforcement to figure out who's looking at that camera. If we can collect the data and isolate the camera information, that camera is sending that data somewhere. It's probably going to a dynamic DNS, and we'll talk about that in the class. And then maybe we have to go to that dynamic DNS server and find out who is connecting to you to look at these videos. Now you have the end user, the person whose phone has the app on it that's looking at that picture. What happens if we need to identify websites, or we need to pull information about a website, or information from a website that isn't there anymore? We do this in the class. We actually have a lab where we go and extract information that exists on a website that doesn't exist anymore. It's not even a registered domain name, but where do we get it from? We talk about the hierarchy of the internet. We talk about how ICANN is the government of the internet and how they've given over the management of the numbers and names to a division called IANA. And we talk about why this had to happen in the first place. This had to happen because Network Solutions decided they didn't want to register the name shiitakemushrooms.com. This nearly broke the internet. If you want to know why, got to come to the class. After that, we talk about data carving. We get into how a file carver works. We use specifically a carver called PhotoRec, probably one of the best data carving tools at any price, and it's free. We can point that at a hard drive, and it will use various methodologies that we teach in class to go into unallocated space on a hard drive and recover deleted files. And we talk about how it works, and we demonstrate how it actually pulls out, identifies, pulls out, and saves that file. And then we talk about something very, very uncomfortable. We talk about what you've been missing. Now, this really only applies mostly to people who've been doing forensics for a while. Because if you've never done forensics at all, and that's why you're here, is to learn forensics, you haven't made these mistakes. But for those people that have been doing forensics for some time, they know from doing data carving that they've recovered many files where they double click and it throws an error message, Microsoft Word can't open this, it's a corrupt file. So they delete it and go to the next one. We show you what you were missing. And it's a terrifying moment for many. But then we go one step further. What if your file carver couldn't find the file? This is why we data carve. And when I talk about this kind of data carving, this is the real data carving. Not the file carving that your tool is able to extract. In what way? Well, the way that these tools work, they need a file header. Every file, 99.9% of files, have these things called file headers. They're the first few bytes of a file, the magic bytes. Let me see if I can give you an example of one. I'm just going to open up a hex editor here. So I've got a hex editor open, and let's see if we can find a file to look at in here. Let's go to our image. Let's see if we can find some files that we can look at. And here in this case, this is a CSV. Let's have a look at that one. Let's see if this will work for us. So we're going to go open up that CSV file. Now, in a hex editor, this is not for the faint of heart. you're going to see data showing in ways that are kind of scary to us, right? Like this is ugly. This doesn't look like really anything. And this is a bad example. I want to see if I've got a better example here. Let's see, what kind of file is this? It's a JPEG. Okay, this will be a good example. So let's bring this JPEG file into the tool. And the tool saves us from ourselves to make sure that we don't make any mistakes. In other words, it's not going to let us open something because we're running as administrator and we could potentially cause a lot of damage. So we're just going to go and grab this file manually. And we open it up in a hex editor. And again, this is not easy to look at if you haven't looked at it before. But these are the magic bytes. FFD8FF are the magic bytes of a JPEG. A photo, a picture of some kind, a JPEG file. And it is always, always, always. If we go to the end of the file of the JPEG, we see this looks kind of like a YU. It's FFD9. That's the file footer. Now, not all files have a file footer, but many do. The idea behind all of this is just to say that the file carving tool needs to look at this. It's going through tons and tons of this hexadecimal. When it sees FFD8FF, it knows that's a picture. And it's going to start carving that file from here all the way to the end and saving it out as a JPEG. But what happens if the magic bytes are not there anymore? What if the magic bytes have been overwritten by something else? Well, guess what? Your file carving tool is not going to find it now. And it's just going to keep on going and you will never know it was there unless you know some of the advanced ways to look and some of the advanced ways to do data rebuilding. We do that in the class. We teach you how to find data, how to repair data, how to stitch data together and edit it in a hex editor so that the file will open and to show that information. Really, really great features, really, really great capabilities. So this brings us to the end of the webinar, the demonstrations. I hope that you enjoyed them. I hope this gave you some insight. If you were sitting on the fence whether or not to take the class or not, I hope that this has helped you make that decision. One of the biggest takeaways here is that the information hasn't changed. When we first created Battlefield Forensics and data acquisition, you know, we picked that name for a specific reason. Unfortunately, it didn't resonate with some people. And while it was a great name for some, others didn't quite understand what that name meant. When people come to you and say, you know, what class is this? Oh, it's Battlefield Forensics. Well, what does that mean? That's the wrong question. When people are asking that question, we've got a bad name. We recognize that. Mea culpa. We have changed the name to better reflect what the class is. And it is now Data Acquisition and Rapid Triage. It continues to grow and get refined and get updated and new, more relevant material gets added all the time. It's still the same great class, just a different, more relevant name. Certainly hope to see you in a class in the near future.